and welcome to the state we're in. I'm Melanie Plenda. The historic 2020 election has been a nail biter. As of this date, we still don't know who has won the presidency. But here in New Hampshire, we're seeing results that could have a significant impact on the next few years. Here to discuss the election results and what we're going to see going forward is Dante Scala, Associate Professor of Political Science at the University of New Hampshire. Thank you for joining us, Dante.
You're very welcome.
So lots of people are calling this election historic. Why?
I think it's historic because ultimately it will be because of high, high voter turnout. I think we've seen on the Democratic side a great amount of voter enthusiasm, if that's the right term, emotion anyway, surrounding the presidency of Donald Trump. And I think it's been the last 4 years has been Democrats really all bracing and climbing toward this moment. And then, of course, there's the Trump presidency itself, which will be historic one way or another, I think, in terms of its significance to American politics, perhaps as a mirror of the state we're in as a country right now. So I think for those reasons, it will be certainly, it will be remembered. And the Trump presidency in general, I think, really for me as a political scientist, signals a marking point. I think there will be American politics before Donald Trump and then American politics after Donald Trump.
Interesting. And can you talk a little bit about that? What do you think, just if that's a marking point for you, what do you think the after Donald Trump might look like?
Well, in nationally, I think we're at an inflection point where the country is going through drastic demographic changes. You know, we're moving from a majority white society to a truly multiracial society. And when there are these demographic transitions, even though they're long in coming, I do think they have profound political consequences. So one way to think about Donald Trump's presidency is perhaps the last gasp of the old order of things, and which were supported by people who felt threatened by their status in society, by all the things that were changing. And I think for them, Donald Trump represented a champion. But nonetheless, those demographic changes are going to keep occurring. And so I do think we'll see a different type of American politics going forward that won't resemble the past. You know, for instance, take the Republican Party. The last two nominees of the Republican Party were Mitt Romney and Donald Trump. Two more different people, two more different Republicans, it would be hard to think of. I would not bet on the Republican Party simply going back to nominating more Mitt Romneys. It's much more likely, in my opinion, that if Donald Trump himself does not run in 2024, that assuming that he loses the presidency this time, if he doesn't run, I think there's a very good possibility that someone like him will run who will try to keep together the Trump coalition of voters that got him the nomination in the first place.
Which brings me to a question then about the electorate itself. I mean, this campaign in particular has been so divisive, just among the voters, among people. Will we ever be able to have conversations with people we disagree with again? I mean, if that sort of tracks the way you're seeing it.
Yeah, it's a real dilemma. I think that people not only are having difficulty conversing, but they almost appear to live in two different worlds sometimes. With two different sets of facts. And when you can't agree on common facts, it presents a real difficulty in having that kind of conversation. So that's, you know, one thing to watch going forward. I do take some consolation, perhaps, in the promise of Biden's presidency as perhaps a period of normalcy. I mean, I think it turned out to be Biden's superpower, is that unlike Trump, unlike Barack Obama, Joe Biden is to all appearances, an ordinary politician, a normal politician. He doesn't represent great change one way or another. And perhaps part of the reason Biden seems poised to take the presidency is because he was a breath of normalcy in very unusual times. So perhaps Biden's legacy might be restoring some sense of normalcy and calmness, which might make people who are not extremely partisan in America happier that the volume is being turned down.
Sure. And speaking of sort of alternate facts, has the political climate changed your teaching in any way?
I think it's always a challenge in the classroom to make all students comfortable in expressing their opinions. And that's been true since the first day I walked into the classroom. I think it's especially true now. And I think it's true on both sides of the aisle. So making conservative students comfortable expressing their opinions, as well as liberal or progressive students, is important to me. And I think it requires me always to try and listen first before jumping to conclusions or judgments. I will say, though, that I always take heart from my students, and they seem to handle the Trump era, you know, those 20-year-olds I teach, much more in stride than my colleagues who are, you know, 40 or 50 like myself.
Right, right. And so a little bit moving again closer to home, you've been looking at Granite State political scene for many years. Give us a rundown of where we are in terms of this week's results.
It's been a very interesting split decision. At the top of the ticket, New Hampshire behaved as it has really since 2004. That is, it's behaved as a Democratic-leaning swing state. All the votes haven't been counted nationally, obviously, but as of now, you know, Joe Biden's performance in New Hampshire was just a little bit better than his performance nationally. And that's in keeping with every election over the past couple of decades, except for, you know, the last one in 2016, when Hillary Clinton actually did a little worse in New Hampshire than she did nationally. But this time around, it appears we got back on our former track of being a Democratic-leaning swing state. However, I mentioned a split decision. To me, the most striking, surprising thing that happened in New Hampshire on Election Day was the return to dominance of the New Hampshire Republican Party, led by Governor Chris Sununu, and which has created Republicans owning both houses of the state legislature with majorities after the Democrats had seized control in 2018. And that has all sorts of profound implications for the next decade of New Hampshire politics, most predominantly redistricting. So now, rather than Chris Sununu having to forge a compromise on redistricting with the Democratic legislature, now Republicans will get to redraw the map of New Hampshire politics for the next decade. That means state House districts, state Senate districts, congressional districts. So that's a big change. And going into the election, I thought it was quite possible that what happened up at the federal election level, so the races for president, for U.S. Senate, would have a big down-ticket effect that would hurt Republicans. But instead, what happened was that Governor Sununu really spent his political capital as the most popular Republican in New Hampshire politics today. He spent that capital helping out his fellow Republicans down-ticket. And I think that was at least one factor that led to this split decision. So on the one hand, Democrats control the entire congressional delegation, right? Both senators as well as both House districts. But at the state legislative level, now they're in the backseat And now they're going to have to run in future elections under a Republican-drawn map.
And I'm curious, what might the other factors have been in this split decision? And I was even thinking, I'm wondering, you know, if there's any data or evidence of this yet, of maybe, you know, Republicans possibly reluctantly voting for Joe Biden, but then opting to, you know, keep all the rest of their votes Republican to sort of balance that out? Or is it, you know, the fact that Sununu sort of didn't, and maybe the others didn't sort of ally themselves so closely with Trump? What are some of these other factors, do you think, for why there was this split?
Yeah, I think we're all still sorting that out. But I think your theory is a sound one, that it turns out that at least a segment of New Hampshire voters were uncomfortable with the president, but very comfortable with Chris Sununu type Republicanism. And so, and those voters were very willing to make that distinction by voting for Biden at the top of the ticket, but then voting for Republicans further down ticket. I'll give you a couple of examples. You know, the town of Bedford, for example, which is a very Republican town to the west of Manchester. Actually, Joe Biden carried Bedford, which in past elections would have been unheard of, that a Democratic nominee for president could win the town of Bedford. And yet there it was. So I think that's one part, is that people were willing to distinguish Trump from the rest of the Republican Party. Secondly, you know, Chris Sununu's popularity has been terrific for a sitting governor, and he put up a monster reelect number versus the Democratic nominee Dan Feltes on election day. I mean, when your governor is getting 60%+ of the vote, it's bound to have some effect down ticket for other Republicans. Third, I think Democrats mismanaged their messaging this time around regarding Chris Sununu. They tried to present him as this Trump-light obstructionist. And so they tried to tie Sununu to Trump at every opportunity. Now, and granted, I mean, Sununu has never renounced Donald Trump the way, say, Governor Charlie Baker of Massachusetts has. But they tried to connect Sununu to Trump at every opportunity, and they also tried to make political capital out of the fact that Sununu vetoed so many bills from the Democratic legislature over the past 2 years. And what happened was Chris Sununu basically leaned into all that message. He was sending out mail pieces to voters saying, hey, if you like me and the job I've done over the past 2 years, send me help. Send me Republican legislators to keep the Democrats under control up here in Concord. Now, it's always difficult to know what's going through voters' minds, especially for those down ballot races where they don't necessarily carry a lot of information in their heads. But Sununu, rather than running away and hiding this election, he decided, I'm going to try and help my party to survive in advance. And that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that, how did the pandemic play in there too, or his response to it, or how do you think that played into that decision for voters?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, Chris Sununu will go down in New Hampshire history as one of the most powerful governors ever of the state of New Hampshire. Institutionally, the governorship is weak compared to, say, governors in other states, right? Governors of New Hampshire do not have the same amount of formal powers. Chris Sununu can't even get an appointment without it going through the executive council, for instance. So typically governors are weak here, but voters in New Hampshire look to their governors in cases of emergency. Now, typically that emergency is momentary, a flood, for instance, but the pandemic has been this ongoing public health emergency. And basically from day one, Chris Sununu has been front and center on that, you know, giving press conferences every week, issuing orders. Basically, we've ceded a tremendous amount of power to the governor. And I think that put Sununu front and center and made his political identity even more distinctive from President Trump, especially given the two men's very different reactions to the pandemic. And I think Sununu got high marks from voters for how he's handled things, whereas for the president, that was one more thing to hold against him. And the fact that Sununu was front and center so often over the last several months made the Democratic nominee's job so much more difficult for someone who had very low name ID to start with. You know, how do you compete with all of the publicity that the governor was getting just for doing his job?
And how do you see the new political landscape impacting the continued pandemic response?
I suspect that the governor will continue to remain front and center as long as the pandemic is ongoing. And I think that the Republican legislature will be happy enough to have him do just that. I think that Sununu has built an awful lot of political capital on that. Now, that's not to say that there won't be conservative legislators in Concord who might raise something of a fuss, who, if there's another lockdown, for example, there could be legislators who will object to that. But I suspect they'll probably be a minority of the Republican majority, so to speak, not a majority of the majority, because I think it's going to be very difficult to argue with the governor as long as he's perceived as handling things well.
And turning once again to developments at the national level. So it looks like the polls may have had it wrong. Why is that, do you think?
Yeah, I think we're going to have to wait a little bit before we render a verdict, because we don't know exactly, you know, what the popular vote will turn out to be and how great that margin will be in the popular vote between Joe Biden and Donald Trump. That's one issue. The second issue I wonder about will be the difference between the national and the state polls. You know, 4 years ago, the national polls were actually quite on target. Was the state polls that had some difficulties. I will say here in New Hampshire, my colleague Andy Smith at the UNH Survey Center, his last poll on the statewide margin between Biden and Trump was right on target, as was the St. Anselm poll, as well as a poll we saw from the University of Massachusetts. So at least at the statewide level, I think polling here in the state of New Hampshire was good. I think there will be the inevitable kind of forensics about polls elsewhere, though, because certainly, you know, take Florida, for example, that will register as something of a miss. But it's always important to keep in mind that there's always a margin of error in polling, and the margin of error is especially apparent when it's in a close race, because no one cares if the polls shows a winner by 8 points when it was actually 12. Everybody cares when the polls show a winner by 2% and it turns out to be the other person by 2%. So I think we probably need to wait a bit and see how everything shakes out and all the votes are counted before we decide how polling worked or didn't work.
Sure. And can you explain some of the threats President Trump is making regarding vote count across the country?
I wish I could. I think that I say that because it really appears to be an act of desperation at this point. And I haven't heard of a case yet that has a very sound basis. The best I've heard is just, I think today in Pennsylvania, there was a discussion about or an order about election observers, but nothing to do really with the actual count so far. And in fact, I think we all should be, you know, pleased with our politics and government regarding the voting process. The pandemic really put everyone on high alert, including our elections officials, who are state and local officials, and they are, we're always concerned about our election machinery and how it's going to work and whether they're ready to go. And I think here in New Hampshire, as well as elsewhere, I was happily surprised by the apparent lack of problems and the fact that we were able to, as a country, pull off an election that ran rather smoothly despite the pandemic and all of the changes that had to be done to the process, including by voters themselves. You know, we might stand to have a turnout of 65% or so, which is really high. I mean, more than that's a century high figure. And I think that's all to the good. So as far as the president goes, I mean, until there's, you know, it's one thing to make claims, it's one thing to tweet things and so forth, it's one thing to send Rudy Giuliani here and there, but I don't hear a lot of fellow Republicans right now echoing what the president has to say. And I don't see any real grounds yet. I haven't heard a serious case where there's some serious malfeasance as of yet. So until that, I think it's just a lot of noise.
Sure. And just finally, what is your main takeaway from this election?
Well, my main takeaway is that the Republican Party looks alive and well after Donald Trump. Even if there is a Biden presidency, what we saw down ticket is very instructive because, you know, just like here in New Hampshire, where we saw Joe Biden win, Gene Shaheen win, but also Chris Sununu and state legislators win, we're seeing that around the country as well, that, you know, just because Donald Trump is losing doesn't mean that Republicans lost the Senate, for example. You know, as of this date, it might be the case that Democrats have a chance to get to a 50-50 tie, but that will only be if they can sweep both U.S. Senate seats in Georgia in early January. Fair to say that's not where they expect it to be after Election Day. So on the one hand, that, you know, the Trump presidency might be over, but Democrats' hopes that there would be this realignment around the Democrats because of the Trump presidency, that's not the case. And as a result, even if we do have a Biden presidency, it looks like there will be more of the same in terms of divided government. And so that, to me, is my takeaway.
Wow. Thank you, Dante Scala, Associate Professor of Political Science at the University of New Hampshire, for being with us today.
You're very welcome.
And thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.